Chapter 5.
Am I going to like the kid I meet today? That's what Mr. Gorman asked me as I walked into the gym on Tuesday morning. He was standing in the doorway, holding his clipboard, like he was waiting for me or something. I don't know, I told him. Are you? And I walked straight up to the bleachers, didn't even bother to go to the locker room and change into my gym clothes, and I sat. Trent, he asked me, you planning on participating today? Can't, I said. I twisted my arm helping my mom move furniture last night, and I made a big show of rubbing my arm, my right one. I forgot my note. I'll bring it tomorrow. Mr. Gorman frowned at me. But what else was he going to do? He couldn't exactly pick me up and force me to play basketball. So he just sort of said, noise in his throat, and checked something off on his clipboard, probably the box that said I was a screw-up. I spent the whole period watching other kids play basketball, which is not nearly as fun as it sounds. I spent all of lunch in the bathroom again, which is even less fun than it sounds. Am I going to like the kid I meet today? Mr. Gorman asked me on Wednesday, still standing at the door, still holding his clipboard. I don't know, I told him. Depends if you like kids who can't play basketball because of their horrible colds. I fake sneezed. I think a little got on Mr. Gorman, which was an added bonus. I'll bring my note tomorrow, I said as I made up my way up the bleachers. Mr. Gorman made a check on his clipboard. By the time lunch on Wednesday rolled around, I was getting pretty sick of the bathroom. So even though I really didn't want to, I went to the cafeteria, bought myself lunch, sat down at a completely empty table in the corner. Guess who decided to sit down next to me? Trent! I tried to make myself look so large that I took up the whole table, but Fallon found room anyway. Hey, she told me. You're here! Yeah. I held up my tuna sandwich to show her. It's lunch. But you weren't in the cafeteria yesterday, she said. Or Monday, either. She just shrugged. No way I was going to tell her I'd been hanging out in the bathroom. Well, I'm glad you're here now, she opened her chocolate milk like an expert, took a long swig. I wanted to tell you something. I sighed. I didn't want to talk to her about her stupid scar anymore. I didn't want to argue with her about drawing her weird pictures. Don't you have any friends? I asked her. All right. It came out meaner than I meant it. Fallon froze, halfway to her apple. Hand just froze in midair, like she'd been zapped or something. But then, just when I thought she was going to burst into tears like a real girl, she unfroze herself and grabbed the apple, like nothing had happened at all. Like the freezing had just been a fritz in my vision. Don't you? She asked. Well, that was a fair point. I sighed again. What did you want to tell me? I asked. She took a bite from her apple. Today I noticed she was wearing a yellow and pink checked dress with a rounded collar, like a four-year-old might wear for Easter. Where did she get these clothes? I was going to tell you the real story of how I got my scar. Oh, brother. I still had half a sandwich to finish, plus a whole bag of chips, and I had nowhere to be but a bathroom stall, so finally I gave in. Fine, I said. Tell me, how did you get that mysterious scar of yours? Her eyes lit up on either side of the scar. It really was a thing to look at. Lightning bolt, she told me. I was standing under a tree during a lightning storm. You know how they tell you never to do that? And I got struck. She made a slicing motion with her non-apple-holding hand. Boom! I was out cold for an entire hour. When I woke up, I had the scar. I focused on my sandwich. A glop of tuna was threatening to fall into my cardboard tray. I caught it with my tongue. Were you all by yourself when it happened? I asked as I chewed. Fallon nodded. Then how do you know how long you were out for? Good point, she said. She took another bite of apple and chewed slowly, swallowed. I'll work on that. Don't you ever talk about anything else? I wondered. I'd been thinking about it, and actually I was pretty sure that Fallon Little wasn't friendless. She wasn't one of the loner kids like Ian Holt, who spent every recess huddled in a corner behind the handball court playing Connect Four by himself, or even like Mindy Fitzgibbons, who made best friends with the librarian and hung out with her every day for all of elementary school. In fact, not that I'd spent a lot of time paying attention to Fallon, but just on remembering, it seemed like she always had someone to sit with at lunch, always had someone to partner with on projects, but I was pretty sure it was always someone different. I was starting to figure out why. Like what? Fallon asked. What else is there to talk about? I don't know, I said. Anything. Baseball, the Dodgers. How about that? She took another bite of her apple. Have you seen Field of Dreams? Fallon asked me. Well, I didn't see that coming. Field of Dreams? I said. Yeah, it's a movie about baseball. This farmer guy hears this weird voice and decides to make a baseball field, and then all these baseball players who are, like, dead or whatever come play baseball. I know what it's about, I told her. But you've never seen it? I saw part of it. I didn't want to tell Fallon that my mom had been trying to get me to watch it forever, because she said it was the best baseball movie of all time. But when she first tried to make me watch it when I was six, I got freaked out by all the creepy whispering, "If you build it," and I screamed until she turned the TV off. You should watch all of it, Fallon said, if you like baseball. Or The Sandlot. Have you ever seen The Sandlot? No. Talking baseball movies was way better than weird scar stories, but I was still trying to figure out which was worse, eating lunch with Fallon or starving in a bathroom stall. I have both of them, Fallon said. You can come over and watch with me sometime. I choked on the last of my sandwich when she said that. You okay, Trent? She asked. She looked like she was about to start giving me the Heimlich, right there in the cafeteria, so I nodded and downed some apple juice until she seemed to believe I wasn't going to die. Well, what do you think? Want to come over sometime? I was still coughing a little bit, so luckily I didn't have to answer right away. Here's what I knew for sure. Fallon wasn't asking me over to her house as, like, a date or anything. I'd seen the way girls acted when they liked boys that way. Heck, hang out with Aaron for more than 3 seconds and you'd see plenty of it. And that wasn't the way Fallon seemed to be acting. She seemed, if I really thought hard about it, like she wanted to be my friend. But here's the thing I couldn't figure out. Why me? Out of all the kids at Cedar Haven Middle, why me? I wasn't particularly funny, or nice, even, and I was good at sports, but Fallon didn't seem to care so much about that. Maybe, I told her, probably not. Fallon nodded as she took another bite of her apple, like that was exactly the answer she expected. Okay, she said, and she grinned, apple flecks showing in her mouth. Then how about you draw me a picture? I thought about breaking another one of Miss Emerson's plants just to get detention, but I figured 2 phone calls in 1 week might be too much for my mom. Also, the wrinkled old crone would probably just kill me instead. I've been ignoring her, mostly in class. Not answering questions, scribbling thoughts instead of doing homework, that sort of thing. You could tell the wrinkled old crone hated me back because she didn't seem to mind so much about the ignoring. Anyway, there were other ways to miss dinner. First, I went to the Episcopal Church on Summit Avenue because they had the best parking lot for practicing wheelies. Then I biked down Buffalo Head Lane, mostly because I really liked the word buffalo head, and wound my way in and around the fallen leaves on the street until an old lady honked her horn at me and told me to stop being a nuisance on her block. Then I biked past the high school, where someone had set up a collection of lawn gnomes from who knows where on the front lawn. After a while, I wandered over to Knickerbocker, although I pedaled really fast as I passed the Richards' house. I soared down Maple Hill, closing my eyes for just a second as I went. There was just enough wind pushing me back against the road that between the pushing and the soaring, I could almost believe it was flying. Floating. 2 tacos. That's what I had for dinner. They were 2 for $5 if you got them from the takeout window of Rosalita's. Mom and I picked food up there a lot when we were working late at kitchen things because it was right down the block. And Marjorie, who ran the window, was always really nice. Nothing for your mother? She asked when she handed me the bag. I shook my head, sliding $5 from my last shift weekend. From my shift last weekend across the wood counter. She might come by later, I said. Which then, I wish I hadn't said, because maybe it would come true and Mom would go over, and then Marjorie would tell her that she saw me, and then Mom would be mad that I wasn't having dinner with my dad like I was supposed to on Wednesday nights. But I figured there was no fixing it now. I waited until Marjorie was busy at the fryer, and I turned left instead of right, the way I would normally go to get back to the store, and I hopped back on my bike and headed to the park. It wasn't the worst, eating delicious tacos on a bench in the park, even if I was all by myself. And it was a little chilly, too, especially since I was just in my sweatshirt and jeans. Friday, I'd have to wear a jacket or something. I guess I did a real good job with the wandering, because Aaron and Doug were already there by the time I got home. Aaron slugged me in the arm, called me an idiot, and said that he was done, absolutely done, covering for me with Mom and Dad. And if I was going to miss dinner one more time, I was going to have to explain it myself. He didn't say anything about Dad being super sad to miss me or anything, so I could figure out how that went. Mom had to work late, so it was just me and Aaron watching the game, Padres again. Although you could hardly call what Aaron was doing watching because he had his head half buried in his trigonometry book the whole time. Normally, Aaron was nearly as fanatical about baseball as Mom, but I didn't bother asking why he didn't feel like watching, because knowing Aaron, he'd only use the opportunity to lecture me about responsibility or something. Doug didn't care so much about baseball. You could tell he didn't care because he spent most of the first inning poking me in the back, saying he needed to talk to me in private. He was working on another prank, obviously. "Doug, quit it," I told him. "I'm trying to watch the game." Doug finally stalked off until Aaron's cell phone rang, and Doug snatched it off the table before Aaron could get it and immediately started gushing like a baby. "Aaron," he said, like our brother's name was a million syllables long. "It's a girl calling you. Who's Clarice?" Aaron hopped off the back of the couch, his trigonometry book tumbling to the floor, and grabbed the phone away from Doug. "Give me that," he went to his room to take the call, and Doug plopped into Aaron's seat beside me. "You think Aaron has a girlfriend?" Doug asked me. I shrugged. "You gotta hear my prank," Doug said. And I couldn't really argue, because it was a commercial anyway. "Fine," I said. "Shoot." "Okay." Doug was bouncing already, even sitting down. "Rebecca has a hamster, right? So what if I borrowed it, and me and her and Annie let it loose in Aaron's room? And then, while he was sleeping, it would, like, nibble at his toes. It would totally freak him out." I guess he saw me rolling my eyes, because he said, "What? You don't think that's good?" "That's a horrible prank, Doug. No way will Rebecca let you borrow a hamster. And anyway, it would just get lost or end up in the toilet or something, and then Rebecca would hate you." Doug sucked his lip out, pouting. But I guess he couldn't really argue with me. "You got any better ideas?" he asked, crossing his arms over his chest. I did. I had plenty of good prank ideas. Hiding all of Aaron's underwear, tying his doorknob to the bathroom across the hall so he couldn't get out of his room, reprogramming his voicemail to something embarrassing. I was full of ideas, and I hadn't done a good prank in a long time. But if I told Doug any of those things, he'd just want to do them with his friends, with Annie. "The game's back on," I told Doug. And he stuck his lip out again like a little baby. But really, what did I care?